Hey folks, it's good to see you tonight. Hey, I got a question for you. Does anybody remember the power team? Do y'all remember? Did y'all ever have the power team come to your church or an event that was close to you? Did you go see them? Power team, the strength team, those guys, they bend rods and they rip phone books in half and they display the power that God has given them physically, and they use that and tie that into sharing the gospel, the power that comes from the freedom that Christ brings. I remember we hosted them one time when I was growing up, and our not just our church, but a community event in our area. A bunch of people came. People got saved because they found true power. Power is something that we want, that we think about, that would be great to have. But is it something that we pray for? Now, not necessarily the power to rip a phone book in half, but do we pray for power from God? Do we pray that God would use us for his power and use his power in us to impact the kingdom? I believe Paul did. I believe Paul prayed that not only for himself, but for the church in Ephesians. And that's what we're going to look at. We're going to look in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21 tonight, and look at how Paul prayed for power and how you and I can pray for power, not to do whatever we want with, but for the building up of his kingdom. So let's read Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. It says this: "For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. I pray that he may grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with his power in your inner being through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. I pray that you, being rooted and firmly established in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the length and width, height and depth of God's love, and to know Christ's love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen." So let's look at this prayer that Paul had for power. The first thing I want you to notice is that he prayed kneeling. It was his posture in prayer. It wasn't that he was just coming to the Lord flippantly or just doing what he took some time to kneel. It says, "I kneel before the Lord God." He took time to put himself in a position that showed God was king and he was his subject. Listen to what he says. He says, "I knelt before him." And kneeling was not something that was done in a Jewish culture much. People didn't kneel a whole lot. It just wasn't very dignified, if you will. I don't particularly kneel when I like to kneel when I pray. I love to go on prayer walks and things, but I don't necessarily kneel a lot. But kneeling was something that Paul did here to show that God is in control and he is his loyal subject. He was showing his gratitude toward the Lord, his desperation for the Lord. Maybe it's not necessarily getting on our knees, but kneeling in our heart to get our minds right when we pray that the Lord is in control and not us. But not only was his posture one of reverence, but listen to what he was asking. He was asking for two things. He was asking for power and asking for love. Listen to some of the things he says in verses 16 through 19. He says, "Let us be strengthened with power, rooted and firmly established in love, so we can understand, so we can grasp, so we can comprehend God's love, to know Christ's love, to be filled with the fullness of God and according to the power that works in us." Love and power over and over and over again here is what Paul is praying. And he's praying that the people in this church, in the Ephesus church, would experience a deep love of God. The deep love of God that he is describing in chapters 1 and 2 and in the earlier part of chapter 3. Now, he's saying we want to be strengthened by God's power. Right off the beginning, he said, where? In the inner man. Power on the inside. The Lord inside us, giving us that power. That's how we fight sin. That's how we proclaim the gospel. That's how we love people. It's the Lord using his power inside us to make a difference on the outside. Why? Why is that? Because Christ dwells in us. That's what Paul says. The Holy Spirit is in us. Christ is in us. That almost sounds, hey, we've heard one way or we've heard the other. Listen, it's both. Christ is in us. The Holy Spirit works in us to lead us to Christ and help us to understand. The Old Testament idea is tabernacle. they went to the tabernacle. That's where the Lord dwelt. That's where the Lord lived, and that's how they met the Lord. But now they don't have to go to a tabernacle. He's in with them. He lives inside them. We tabernacle with the Lord is really what it says. And because he's inside us, those of us who've caught on to the name, and he's inside us, he gives us the strength and the power to go and to do the things that he wants us to do, to live the life that he wants us to live. And we need that power to help us understand, some translations say grasp or comprehend God's love. Now, God's love is something I want to talk about this afternoon, because a lot of times when we think about understand or grasp or comprehend, we instantly go intellectual, right? We think we need to think about it. We need to get all the nuances of it and understand that. But that's not exactly what Paul is saying here. It's not just intellectual, but it's experiential as well. Now, I want to caution us all. I think one of the worst things that happened with Christendom is we go to these extremes when it comes to experience. We either put all our eggs in the experience basket or none. And I think both of those are wrong, because we have to be careful to not abuse experience, not to say it's all about this feeling or this experience, because experience not filtered through the lens of the Word of God can lead us to mysticism and lead us to a place where we're worshiping this experience rather than the Creator. And we have to have this feeling or this event to feel like we've met with the Lord. And that's not the case. But then the other end of the spectrum is people go so far to avoid experience and say, no, it's all about the truth, and any kind of experience is bad because it's a feeling and your feelings can mislead you. And I feel like that's a wrong avenue to go to as well, because as one of my professors said, Tony Morita, he said, when you are lacking or devoid of experience and trying to disregard experience, You're leading to a cold, dead orthodoxy that is just not beneficial for anything. So we need it. Here's how we gauge experience, church family. Experience in itself is not good or bad. The experience might be, but the idea of or nature of experience, how we gauge whether or not it's from the Lord is if it lines up in the Word of God. I believe everything God ever wants to say to us is right here in his word. And if we go to the point of saying God told us to do something and it doesn't align with God's word, then he didn't tell us, okay? He's not going to speak against his word. Matter of fact, if you feel like God has told you something, you need a chapter in reference with it, okay? You need to go to his word and see if it lines up. God is not going to give you a leading that's contradictory to his word. And so we need to understand that God speaks through his word, but he leads us to experiences where we feel closer to him, maybe, or we feel his presence more. We understand that he is around us more. And so what I want us to do is not gauge our experiences based on just how they make us feel, but how they make us feel and compared to lining up with the word of God. But notice he says he wants us to grasp this with whom? With all the saints. He's talking about all the believers everywhere. So your color, your race, your nationality, your language, none of that matters. We are supposed to worship and celebrate with all the saints. Now, it's hard for us to celebrate and worship with a lot of folks who we may not speak their language. But you know what? That's where some experience can come in. And just being together and experiencing the fellowship that we have with one another. Because we are called as a family, no matter, we at First Baptist are a faith family, but we are a family with every Bible-believing, gospel-centered church, people who know Jesus all around the world. We are part of a family with them. And so we celebrate that with them, and we celebrate with them what the Lord is doing. Because not only are we supposed to celebrate, and we're supposed to experience this with all the saints, but we're supposed to understand the limitless measures of God's love. He says, love with all the height and breadth and width and in depth and all those things. And let me just tell you, There is no bounds. There is no end. There is no way to measure the immeasurable love of the Lord. God's love does not end. It reaches to all places. And so that's what he's wanting them to experience. That's what he's wanting them to see, the power that comes from the Word of God, the power that comes from a relationship with Jesus. And then he ends his prayer with praising God. And he praises him because, number one, because of what he can do. Not what we can do, but what God can do through us and what God will do through us. And God's, number two, God's work in us. You see, God does things in us to move us into more Christ likeness. And so we want to be the kind of people who are letting him work in us, doing what only he can do. And pointing to us, we praise God because of not just what he's doing in us, but because he is the only one worthy of our prayer, of our praise, excuse me. So tonight, what are we going to do? I'm going to ask you to pray tonight. When you cut this off, I'm going to ask you to pray. And I want you to do a couple things. Number one, in your prayer, acknowledge that God is the only true God. Paul knelt. Maybe you don't need to kneel. Maybe you need to get away. Maybe you need to go to a place just for a few minutes away from the rest of your family. And maybe, dads, we need to lead our family in prayer, acknowledging that God is in control of everything. The coronavirus, he's in control of. He's in control of the social distancing. He's in control of the good or the bad. He is in control. Nothing is catching him by surprise. We need to pray, reminding ourselves that he is in control. And when we do that, we change the attitude we have about things, right? We don't just go along saying, well, whatever happens, happens. But we say, God, how do you get glory from this? We give him honor in it. So we change our attitude by acknowledging he is Lord. And then the next, we need to hold on to the promises that he makes in these verses. Listen to those promises. That all we have comes from the riches of his glory. It's his, and he's made it available to us. The power he gives us is made available by him to us. Not that we conjure or make it up. He brings it on himself. And when that happens, we do things like love our neighbors better, because we realize God is giving us the ability, the power to do those things. So right now we love our neighbors more and more, especially while things are so distant. We make sure we reach out to those around us. And then we would pray that we would experience the love of Christ and show the love of Christ with everyone we contact, everyone we meet, just as it is described in Scripture. Notice I'm balancing. So we pray, Lord, help us experience your love as it's described in Scripture. That it's not, we're not making some false love up that comes from what we think, but we are experiencing the love of God based on your word. The love of God based on the word of God. That'll preach. Hey, listen, thank you all for being with us. Let me pray for us. And then I'm going to just encourage you to spend some time praying with your family tonight. God, I thank you so much for today. And I thank you for everyone who was able to watch our Bible study today. God, I thank you that they're so faithful to you and your word, even in this crazy time. Lord, I pray right now that you would work in us. We know you already are. Make us aware of it. Maybe that's really what the experience is, Lord, us being aware of what you're doing. And so help us to be aware of what you're doing. Help us to be obedient to what you're calling us to do, knowing that our power comes from you. And help us to know the immeasurable distance, the immeasurable width, the immeasurable love that you have for us. And that is what drives us to minister to each other, to love our neighbors, and to continue to love our family together. Not just our church family, but the church and the Christians all around. Help us to be stronger. Help us to be strengthened in our innermost being so that your power can be seen through us. Lord, we love you so much, and we pray these things in your name. Amen. Hey, I love you guys. Y'all have a great rest of your evening, and we will see you Sunday, actually, or tomorrow on Facebook, but Sunday. See ya. Love you guys. Bye.